Hello, I hope your weekend is going good. We're going to be looking today about being happy and not worrying in our life. And the title of this message is Don't Worry, Be Happy. And it comes from Philippians, the first chapter, first several verses. We won't be reading all of that, but we'll be looking at some selected verses. Please join me in a time of prayer. Father God, I just pray that you guide and direct and lead us in all that we do. Father, I just pray for those who are hurting today and those who are facing uncertain times, that you would bless them and help them and watch over them. Just pray that all that's said and done, Lord, in this message will bring glory and honor to you. And we lift this up in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Well, in 1988, singer-songwriter Bobby McFerrin wrote one of the most beloved anthems to happiness of all time. And on September 24th, 1988, Don't Worry, Be Happy became the first a cappella song to reach number one on the Billboard Top 100 chart. I remember when I first heard this song, I couldn't help but just put a smile on my face because it made me happy. Well, we're going to be looking in the book of Philippians at the Apostle Paul, and it's one of the most upbeat books and was written during probably one of the most difficult times of Paul's life. He was in prison facing uncertain future, possibility of execution. And while some of his so-called Christian brothers and fellow ministers actually took delight in his predicament, this book of Philippians, Paul brings a brimming amount of joy and enthusiasm. What Paul is really talking about is living a life of joy, a joy rooted in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Abraham Lincoln once said, "Most folks are about as happy as they make up their minds to be." There's a lot of truth to that. Because when it comes down to it, happiness is a choice we make. It's a habit that we develop. Long-term, happiness has nothing to do with your circumstances, but everything to do with your thoughts and options and attitudes about your circumstances. Over the years, there have been countless studies done on the subject of happiness. University of Minnesota study, David Lacken, discovered that there's an amazing little connection between one's life circumstances and one's predominant mood. He studied people in all kinds of situations and circumstances, some who had great fortunes, some just as winning the lottery or are doing great in their business, and others had great misfortune, like suffering health problems or losing their legs in a serious accident. Dr. Lacken discovered that the overwhelming majority of people return to their usual temperament within a year of their fortune or their misfortune. In other words, winning the lottery doesn't really make people happier in the long run. If they were unhappy before, they will eventually go back to that pattern. A Stanford University study in 1994 revealed that happy people and unhappy people tend to have similar life experiences. It's not that happy people experience one success after the other, and unhappy people experience one failure after the other. Their lives are pretty much the same in that aspect. The difference, the study concluded, is that the average unhappy person spends more than twice as much time thinking about unpleasant events in their lives, while happy people tend to spend about that same amount of time looking at their personal outlook in a brighter way. Happiness is a habit. It's a choice you and I make. It doesn't really matter what kind of circumstances we face. It matters that we are habitually thinking about our attitude. Are you habitually adopting the thing that you're looking at and thinking about? So the first big lesson to learn is how to be happy for the rest of your life. Happiness is a habit that you must develop. Happiness will not seek you out and come to you in the form of a better job, a financial windfall, or perfect love relationship. An ultimate acquisition, happiness will not find you because it's not looking for you. If you want to be happy, you need to recognize happiness is a choice you make and a habit you develop. If you want to be happy for the rest of your life, you have to let go once and for all the ideas that happiness will come to you in the shape of some more pleasant circumstances. Your circumstances will never and really meaning never bring you happiness. People were surprised several years ago when movie star Owen Wilson attempted to take his life. He seemed to have it all. He was successful, rich, famous, and everybody loved him. What in the world did he have that was made him so unhappy? That's what so many people ask, and that is what I want you and I to understand. If you're still hanging on to the idea that if you could have what he had, fame, wealth, success, then your problems would all disappear and you'd be happy, then you're still not getting the message. If you still say, if only I could have what that guy has and walk in his shoes, I would trade places in a minute. If I could only have what he or she has, then I would be happy. Well, then you're nowhere near experiencing happiness. Happiness comes from within. It's a choice that you make, a habit you develop. With this in mind, today I want to talk to you about three things that will help us nurture the habit of happiness in our life. There are three things that we can help us break the pattern of typically being unhappy and help us create a happiness set point, so to speak. And the first one is to have a thankful heart, having a thankful heart. Now, Paul said in this letter of Philippians, in chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making requests for you all with joy. Now, notice the proximity of the two words, thank and joy. There's a connection between the two. You see, if again in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, where he says, be joyful always, and 5:18 says, give thanks in all circumstances. Do you want to be filled with joy and happiness? Well, start by saying thanks. It is impossible to be unhappy and thankful at the same time. Think about that. It's impossible to be unhappy and thankful at the same time. They just don't mix. They're like acid and alkali. They repel one another. When you can't think and say, oh God, I'm thanking you for this job and for remaining with me all the day. When you can't say, thank you, Lord, for my spouse, and remain critical of him and her all the time. You can't say thank you for my life and complain about every inconvenience you have to endure. When you start saying thank you, you close the door on this personal and perpetual state of dissatisfaction, and you open a new door that leads to joy and happiness and contentment. Just like Paul begins his letter with a statement of thanks, I encourage each of us to begin each day with a statement of thanks. In the book, The Energy Addict, John Gordon suggests that we start each day with a 10-minute thank you walk. Of course, the physical exercise is a good idea, a great way to start the day. But the best part of Gordon's advice is that you make it a habit of saying thank you the first thing in the morning every day of your life. I've told you before how at my previous job, I would get out and walk around the block, and I call that my praise walk. Because every step that I took, I tried to find something that I could praise the Lord for. And it's amazing how good you felt after walking and praising God during that time. Now, there's always going to be things happening around us that don't go the way that we want them. Your spouse will make you mad sometimes. Your boss, if you still have a boss, will still expect too much of you sometimes. Your body will still ache and act up sometimes. And if you want to waste energy asking God, well, why is my life better? Why isn't this different? Why isn't it easier? The truth is, the more you think on these things, the more you will nurture the unhappiness and frustration in your life. And the truth is, while there may be some things in your life that are less than perfect, there's also thousands of things that are wonderful, beautiful, incredible, and memorial. Make it your practice to thank God for these things first day and every day throughout the day. If you need to, you can make a list of the things you have to be thankful for: your life, your health, your friends, your family, your possessions. A study done at the University of California, Davis, found that people who maintained a weekly gratitude journal were more optimistic about the future and had a greater sense of life satisfaction. Now, Ben Franklin said this: happiness is produced not so much by great pieces of fortune that seldom happen, but as little advantages that occur every day. Make it a point to look for those little advantages, to say thank you each day for each one. Now, the second thing I want us to look at is to consider that we would look for the silver lining. Look for the silver lining. We always have heard that cliche. It goes back to Milton. Every cloud has a silver lining. The saying came about because storm clouds, which were very dark, often have a silver gleam of sunlight along one edge. And the idea is that as long as this storm is with us and we can see the cloud and see that little lining, we know that our troubles will soon go away. Well, maybe you've even heard the old song, "Look for the Silver Lining." When every cloud appears in the blue, remember somewhere the sun is shining. And so the right thing to do is to make that sun shine on you. A heart full of joy and gladness will always banish sadness and strife. So always look for the silver lining and try to find the sunny side of life. And this is exactly, I believe, what Paul did when he wrote Philippians. Here he is, stuck in a prison, no doubt saying, "Woe is me." He could have said that. "Woe is my life. I'm stuck here in jail. I can't go where I want to do. Lord, what's going on? Don't you know I have a ministry that I need to be taking advantage of?" But that's not what Paul did. Paul found a way to say, you know what? The situation may not be good, but something good can come of that. Something good can come out of any situation in life and any circumstance that we find that may not be pleasant at the time. And Paul goes on to write in Philippians 1, 12 through 14, "I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it may become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord have become confident of my chains and are much more bold to speak the word without fear." He's saying this: "I'm in prison, and since my message has been silenced, many people have risen up to take my place. And so where there's only one preaching the good news before, now there are many. Hardly a day goes by that we don't get hit with some piece of bad news. You can either let the bad news defeat you, or you can find the blessing in it. People who experience tragedy in their lives have said afterwards, as bad as that tragedy was, it gave me the opportunity to reconnect with my faith, to reevaluate my priorities, to restore my relationship with my family." And you know, I've looked at this coronavirus time as being a similar thing. It's a time that God has given us, even though there's a lot of tragedy, a lot of deaths, a lot of heartbreak. People have lost their jobs and money and different situations. But if we really look at this, it's a time that we can reconnect with families. It's a time that we can refresh our relationship with our God, that He gives us time to actually read His word and study and think and pray. There's a lot of good things that can come out of any negative situation in life. And we can see how Paul took this attitude to the next level and applied it to his colleagues in ministry who were trying to stir up trouble for him. Today, we have the advantage of history, and we could recognize the authority of Paul and his rightful place in church leadership. In his day, however, it wasn't like that. Many people were not fond of Paul. They didn't like him. They didn't like his theology, and they considered him far too liberal for those who wanted the Christian faith to be a new form of Phariseeism. So when Paul was put in prison, many of the ones who opposed his leadership became even more bold in their evangelism for that purpose of rubbing it in. And here, listen to what Paul said in Philippians 1, 15 through 18. "Some indeed preach Christ, even from envy and strife, and some from goodwill. The former preach Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? Only that in every way, whether in the pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and in this I rejoice, yes, and will rejoice." Now, Paul could have focused on the fact that these people didn't agree with him 100% of the time on every theological issue, and he could have focused on the fact that these people were motivated by selfish ambition rather than love. He could have spent his energy attacking them and their bad motives, but instead he looked for that silver lining. Whether from false motive or true, Christ is being preached. Where you work, I'm guessing there's someone that you know that doesn't like you. In life, in your family situation, whatever it might be, there are people around us that have a way of taking credit for what's not due them. They have a way of getting out of responsibility, a way of making snide remarks, and sometimes just gloating in your mistakes. And I'm guessing there's someone like that in just about every situation we find ourselves. And you can let that person spoil your attitude, destroy your joy, or you can learn to say, you know what? In spite of everything, this person does add one or two positive elements to the mix. Now, that's hard to do. That's hard to say that, but looking at the situation and getting down on ourselves in our situation, look for that silver lining. And in doing this, you're not endorsing everything that person does, but you are learning to recognize good in all situations, even those whose motives are less than honorable. And if you're not careful, you'll find yourself spending a good portion of each day stressed out about what someone else is doing. Maybe it's a backstabbing person, causing problems for you, over-demanding person, an unappreciative spouse or irresponsible teenager or family member. If you're not careful, you'll let these people rob you of your joy. You'll let them steal your happiness from you. It's much better to say, I can't control what this person does, but I am not going to let them get to me. I will recognize the good they do and trust God to take care of the rest. And this brings us to our third point, that we can expect God's best. Expect the best from God. In Philippians 1, we see Paul's inherent optimism. He believes that God is in control. Ultimately, things are going to work out for the best. In Philippians 1:6, he says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. And he's saying, I believe in you because I believe that God is able to finish what he started in your life. Paul also applied this attitude to his situation. He was facing this uncertain future, and he knew that perhaps he would be tortured or executed for his faith. And yet he said this in Philippians 1:20, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also with Christ, will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. Paul goes on to say in verse 21, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And he then says, I don't know what to do. On the other hand, I want to go to heaven and be with Jesus, but then I want to stay here and serve you and fulfill my ministry. I don't know what's better. In verse 25 of 1 Philippians 1, he says, and being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you for all of your progress and joy of faith. And he's saying, I know that God's in control of this situation. He's in control of my life and your life, and he's going to work all things out for me and for the best, for his glory. In Romans 8:28, it's a verse that we hear quoted a lot. It says that we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. And it's easy to develop a habit of attitude, the right happiness, when you realize that God is in control and that he is working everything out for your good. I know that some of you may be hurting right now. Some are struggling with anger or bitterness, resentment or fear. And these things stand before you as huge obstacles to your happiness. It's hard to be joyful when someone has broken your heart. It's hard to be joyful when tomorrow is cloudy and gray. Happiness is a tough choice to make, but it's a lot easier to ride the wave, whichever circumstances come your way, to let the set of circumstances make you miserable or wait for another set of circumstances to come along and then make you happy for a while. That's how most people do it. They're just riding the waves of good and bad each and every day. But there is a better way. You can create your own happiness. You can develop a happiness mindset. It's a choice that you make. Real happiness has nothing to do with your circumstances, as we said before, and everything to do with your attitude. So this week, I encourage you to start sowing some seeds of happiness as a habit. Start saying thank you. Thank you to God. Thank you to your kids or grandkids. Thank you to your spouse, to your parents, to your grandparents, to people around you in your family. Look for the silver lining of everything, especially in the irritating behavior of others. You can control the things that are around you. You can't control all of your circumstances, but you can control the habits in your life. What's good about this situation, you can say? What's positive? What can I focus on that will lead me to say, this is a great day? Expect the best from God. Trust in God's ability to turn a difficult situation around. Trust God's ability to bring out the best in people. Happiness, yes, is your choice. And it, as we close, as far as we can decide to be, we can make our determination that we're going to look on the bright side of life and not on the negatives. You can be a rock star, a movie star, or a millionaire and still be miserable. We see that every day on TV. You can be broke and barely getting by and filled with joy every day. It's your choice. So for me and for my household, and I pray for you and your household, let's choose to be happy. Let's choose to praise God. Let's choose to be thankful about the situations you're in and look at the blessing. Look at the good side. Look for that silver lining. And don't worry. Be happy. Join me again in prayer. Lord God, I thank you for just allowing us to know that you are in control of our lives and our situations in life. And yes, we're going to face the dark days. We're going to face the storms in life. We're going to face the coronaviruses and other things that come our way. But God, help us look for the outcome of that, the silver lining, realizing that you control these situations and that we will get through them. Lord, help us find the good in being in our homes and not able to get back out and doing things as we may have done before. And let us realize that there will be a day when we will get back. And I pray that this time that we've had together, alone in our homes, maybe confined in some instances, we can look back and say, those were some good days, and I enjoyed having that time with my family, special time with my Lord. And Lord, just thank you for blessing us and watching over us. And it is my prayer that everyone listening today will be glorified and honored by the reading and hearing of this word, and that you will be glorified in what we do each and every day in our lives. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry, be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I need you happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry, be happy. When you're worried, your face will frown.
that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. Be happy. Put a smile on your face. Don't bring everybody back. Don't worry. It will soon pass, whatever it is. Don't worry, be happy. I'm not worried. I'm happy.